Hello and welcome to episode 7 of the Between Two Beers podcast. Tonight we talk to Sam Wilkinson. Wilky is one of New Zealand football's best coaches. He's a former child prodigy who never quite made it in the professional game and turned to coaching at a young age. He's only 35, but he's been coaching for the last 16 years, and he spent time at Birmingham City and West Bromwich Albion in the UK. He picked up his UEFA A licence, and 3 years ago returned to New Zealand, where he coached Melbourne United, led them from the First Division to the Premier League and to the Chatham Cup Final, before this year getting signed by the Wellington Phoenix to coach there. So he's a coach on the rise. He's also perhaps one of New Zealand football's most engaging personalities. He's got strong opinions, he tells a great story, and he's quick-witted, which made this podcast very enjoyable. We touched on his turbulent times playing for Auckland City in 2006 and the fallout with Keryn Jordan, which led to him and Rog leaving the club. We spoke about the highs and lows of his experience at Melville and his reasons for leaving and the pain of losing that Chatham Cup final. We spoke about what it was like playing with Chris Wood before he got signed by an English Premier League side in his Wanderers days. And we talked about some of the sacrifices he's made as a young coach and some of the difficult life decisions which go along with the territory. So great chat, just under 2 hours this one. Hope you enjoy. Sam Wilkinson. Welcome to Between Two Beers.
Thanks for having me, boys. Huge, huge fan of the show.
Good to hear. We are back in our Hamilton office studio this evening. We spent 2 weeks in Auckland at the NZME Studios, but good to be back in our spiritual home. Feels comfortable, feels nice. So it's actually Christmas Eve, so it's a very busy time of year. A lot of footballers and coaches return home to their home cities. Sam has come back from Wellington, where he's been coaching with the Wellington Phoenix, for a little bit of a break, but also for his wedding. So getting married in just under 2 weeks, a very exciting time, and we'll dig into a little bit of that later on. But first, Shay, why don't we get started? How do you know Sam Wilkinson?
I know Sam Wilkinson very well. We were opposition secondary school players, Hamilton Boys High and Hillcrest High School.
Any games in particular that stand out?
No. Okay. We'll difficult 99 season.
We'll come back to that later.
And then we became mates. And then I think in the last 3 years since I came back from Papua New Guinea, I've seen Sam almost every day that I've been in the country until he moved to Wellington. And between him and yourself, Stephen, you guys have probably been my biggest supporters through a few challenging times, particularly in the last 12 months. So this is really, really nice. Nice time of the year to be getting back together and having a chat.
Nicely said.
Mm.
I know Sam. I've known Sam since the early 90s. His dad, Roger Wilkinson, and my dad, Bruce Holloway, worked well. They kind of had a love-hate relationship. Bruce was a sports reporter for the Waikato Times. Roger was the coach of Waikato United. So every weekend we would find ourselves in the same place, tagging along with our dads to watch Waikato United play in the National League. So we formed a friendship, a competitive friendship at times on the sidelines, which has stood the test of time. We played together for Wanderers, Melville, Waikato United, and Sam was my coach at my last season at Melville. So we've covered a lot of ground together. He was good enough of a mate for me to invite him to be part of my groom's party at my wedding about 5 years ago, but unfortunately he had an under-16 team to coach on a weeknight, so he couldn't make it. But anyway, he's repaid the favour by asking me to be part of his groom's party at his wedding in 2 weeks. So very close friendship, I'd say, built on a foundation of taking the piss out of each other, perhaps more than sincerely bigging each other up. So there will be times across this podcast where I may have to say nice things about Sam, and it could be a painful experience, but I'm going to try to be as open and honest as I can, and looking forward to this one very much.
I wish my intro was
yeah
that was really
Can I add to that as well? Just a couple of little things. I think when I was unable to come back from the UK to be in your groom's party, the substitute groomsman was Seamus Martin.
Mm. He did a fine job.
Not as funny though.
No. There was actually, talking about taking the piss, the email that got read out from Sam, it was scandalous, absolutely scandalous writing a message from a wedding. But we'll see if we can repay the favour in some way.
The whole wedding was scandalous.
I think we've all grown up a bit
since a couple of weeks. But on that theme, let's dig into one of the better stories that I've heard you tell, and it actually sort of is the beginning of the end of your National League career, and it involves your time at Auckland City. I think around 2006, where Roger was the coach, father was the coach, and had some turbulent times. You were the central midfielder, and there was a lot of fiery personalities, a lot of clashes there, and it all sort of came to a head. So why don't you kick us off there, Wilkie? What do you remember from that season?
Yeah, I think maybe just to give a little bit of context and backstory, I'd signed for Auckland City the previous season under Alan Jones. They were the reigning champs from the inaugural NZFC season in 04-05. Seamus, you can fact check me if get any of this wrong. So I'd moved there the season before and been very much on the fringe of the starting lineup. I think the darkest moment of that season was coming back to Hamilton.
I don't even say that. these times.
Present company excluded.
Yeah, sorry.
And had come back to Hamilton to play Waikato. My old club for Auckland City was on the bench. And I remember Jonathan Smith got a head knock early doors and was a bit suspect, might have to come off. So Jonesy said, warm up. Be ready. We'll keep an eye on Smithy. And Smithy got through another 10. And every time I came to sit down, Jonesy would go, what are you sitting down for? Go and keep warm. Smithy could go any moment. And a few of my friends and quote-unquote fans were in the crowd. And the longer I spent warming up down the sideline, the more they started chanting and singing. And I never got on for 93 minutes. I warmed up to not get on. So that summed up, I guess, my standing in the group that first season.
Good. It was a good group, though, that Auckland City.
Oh, hell of a team, yeah. It won the league quite comfortably 2 years running. And I guess to intro, Keryn Jordan, God rest his soul, had signed the same season, was quite far and away, I believe, the best player in the league at that time, and had an unbelievable season that season. Goal scoring, was the best player in the league. So you polar opposites in terms of me as the sort of bottom feeder sub trying to break his way in, and Keryn Jordan, the superstar that was the best player in the league, should have been playing in the A-League, I believe. So anyway, got to Christmas and I hadn't been playing, re-signed Hamilton Wanderers, moved back to Hamilton. Checked it in, essentially, in a abbreviated form. Fast forward to the next season, Jonesy steps down, Roger's just come back from England where he's been coaching a lot of youth development, coach education, hasn't coached at first team level or senior level probably since the Waikato United days, but comes back, takes this role and says, he wants to sign me. I initially sort of say like, nah, you know, I was there last season, I left, this is not a good move. And he said, nah, persuaded me. So went there, re-signed, and safe to say, Dad, as a coach, was a different coach coming back to the one that probably left from the old Waikato United days, a lot more idealist, and he was inheriting the best team in the country that had won the league twice, playing, without being disrespectful or anything to the style of play, quite a direct way of playing. And anyway, by his own admission, Dad probably too quickly tried to change the way the team played, which probably straight away meant a little bit more patient with the build-up play. Ball wasn't going into the front men quite as quickly. So there was, it's safe to say, it was the wrong combination from day one. It was never quite the right fit. It's always very difficult
as a coach coming in and taking over a very successful team with a lot of the same players. So without having a terrible start, I think we'd maybe lost one, drawn a couple, 1-3. So we were sitting about third. It was far from catastrophic, but it wasn't top of the table. It wasn't steamrolling everyone.
I feel like Ross McKenzie kickstarted that campaign off with a double.
Shout out Otago at Kiwitia. Drew 2-2, which again was not a great result, although Otago were a tricky team to play against.
Ross McKenzie, big fan of the show.
Yeah, exactly. So Malfoy himself notched a couple. He was one of the ones Roger brought in.
Harry Potter.
Blonde was the... Yeah. Cole Tinker was another one who'd come, and funnily enough, Ben Sigmund was another one of the signings. So some good additions, but all was not well. Keryn had... And again, I apologise to anyone if I've got this slightly wrong, but had a few injuries that season and had potentially had either the beginning or a flare-up of, I think, the cancer, which, again, without knowing the ins and outs, I think he'd had tumours removed from his legs. So, although we didn't know this at the time, was understandably not probably quite at the level he'd been at the season before, which was incredibly high, and was missing a little bit of training and... Essentially, it had been a toxic atmosphere. It hadn't clicked, and we played Canterbury away, drawn 1-1. Ironically, missed a penalty in the last minute to win 2-1, which would have been a good result. We came back into training on the Tuesday. Rog was doing a team meeting, as he did, and Keryn, who had, I don't think had played on the Sunday through the injury, had basically piped up and had a pop at the old man. And... It wasn't a confrontation that you probably wouldn't hear in many football changing rooms. It was him publicly trying to question a little bit because he wasn't happy, and there was probably a few of the other old guard that weren't happy with the way we were playing or some of the changes in the style or what have you. And the old man sort of had to go back, and I wouldn't say it was like in your face aggressive, but it was awkward and it was heated, and I'm in the very awkward position of it's my old man. Now, where it's particularly awkward is I'm quite open to the fact that, like I said, my stand in the group, I wasn't a senior player, I wasn't a main guy.
Were you starting each
game? I had started the first couple. Funnily enough, very, very typical of my career, a bit of a hamstring niggle, missed two or three, and then I think I came back into the squad, came off the bench in the Canterbury game, so I was just coming back in. And just sat in this changing room, and as awkward as it was, some big hitters in the group, all whites, internationals, just felt compelled to stand my dad's corner, essentially. And you are in these moments where you have to make a call on the spot, and I just thought, without even thinking it, I just spurted out, and I can't remember the exact words, but I think the gist of what I was saying, and I knew this was only going to come back at me, was, you know, Keryn, you've missed more training than anyone, you haven't been doing as well, who are you to be questioning what we're doing, so on and so forth.
Was it a little bit more colourful?
No, not the initial one. Right. This is in the change room, so that one was a bit more question, completely understandably. He came back at me, you didn't even stay the whole season last season, who are you to be talking, blah, 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 like this. We went back and forth, and at that stage we were going at each other, but it wasn't like we're in each other's face, effing and blinding. Rogers then knocked it on the head, right, that'll do, I don't mind you getting things out of your system, let's get out, go and warm up. We start doing the warm up, we're stretching, and my take on it was Keryn then has another little go back.
At you?
At me. At which point...
How old are you at this point?
21.
21. Sorry, right. I'm having a go at the best player.
It's madness. But
what was he saying?
I can't remember. I think at this stage, when we came back out, it got a little bit more like, who the fuck do you think you are? Blah, 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 blah.
He probably said a bit more South African than Steve, you do a really good South African accent.
Absolutely disgusting behaviour.
Yeah, there you go.
Were you?
Like I've gone back to that one. And look, and I think you boys will know, while I am not someone who loves confrontation, or I'm essentially soft as shit, but when I go past the point of no return, yeah. I'm quite happy spitting out whatever I think at the time will fight my corner, yeah. And I will probably go over the top with it. So he came back at me. I just thought, I'm not having this. And again, it's a horrible situation because there's John Perry, there's Ricky, there's Grant Young, Ross, there's big hitters there, and I'm now gone back at him and just, I can't remember, it was a tirade of you this and you and that, and next thing I know, I'm basically like nose to nose with Keryn Jordan saying, let's have this out, and doing my usual tactic of just banking on someone getting in the middle of us and stopping it getting to that point. To which Roger's now come back outside and seen this all escalated and basically gone like to both of us, I thought I told you to fucking pack this in. And Keryn then had a go back at Dad. I said nothing. And Rog basically said, if you don't want to shut the fuck up, you can fuck off. And then I hope I can swear on this.
Say your piece.
To which point, Keryn got in his car and left. I think he was probably literally on the phone to Ivan Vuksic as he drove out of the training ground. Trained that night. Funnily enough, I will never forget Brian Little, who was a really good man and was a newbie in the squad as well, actually come up and patted me on the back and said, like, I think he'd clocked the whole dilemma I was in and said, well done, mate, for like sticking up for your dad kind of thing. but then, yeah, and then that night, Rog rang me and said, Ivan's rung me. He said it's not working. I agree with him. We've decided to knock it on the head. Obviously, I was only ever leaving when the old man was leaving. But I think the unfortunate thing was, because the other backstory was, it was the first Club World Cup coming up. First time a New Zealand team had been. So this was all in the background and no one wants to rock the boat. And unfortunately, two of Roger's signings, Ross McKenzie and Cole Tinkler, Ross got... They were very much seen as
painted with the Rog brush.
Dad's lads, right. And Dad's signings. And while Siggy was kind of undroppable and was never going to get binned off, Ross got excluded wrongly from the squad because he'd been doing well. And Tinks survived the cull, but I think ended up a 12-year-old Michael Boxall was getting on in front of him off the bench. So very much was making up the numbers and... And that was a shame, a little bit of collateral damage. Like I said, looking back on it now, it was just a case, it was just the wrong combination. I think Dad's quite open and said, look, he probably went too drastic too early and would have done things a bit differently. And to be honest, was not as in tune with working at first team level as he had been in his heyday. And to follow on from that story, so two nice little prologues that fast forward again the following year. So Dad then goes back, moves back to Hamilton, and Dave Edmondson gets the sack from Waikato at the same time. The Napier brawl, for those of you that may remember that. Dad takes over at Christmas, takes over Waikato FC, or bottom of the league, struggling. I'm obviously go back to sign, find out there's a two-club rule. Not allowed to sign. So spend the second half of the season training, can't kick a ball. Rog keeps the Waikato job for the next season. Again, very common thread. I've been injured pre-season. Missed the first couple of games. Think I came off the bench in about the fourth game against Christchurch. Next game is Auckland City at home. I'm not fit, summer league, but give Rog the, yeah, look, you got to start me. Again, correct me if my scoring is wrong here, but I think we're at the stadium and we are 2-1 down. The Auckland City faithful are in the stand and have just been...
A 2-4-8 or whatever.
Yeah, paying me out the whole game. It's about the 80th minute. I am not match fit. It's stinking hot and I'm literally just running on fumes. I'm just like bumbling around the pitch, running on empty. And like... trundle forward and the ball breaks on the edge of the box. and I'm so exhausted, I literally remember thinking, I'm not even thinking about trying to score, I'm just thinking, I'm going to run up and try and strike this as hard as I can, and all I'm going to worry about is making contact with the ball and not just like falling over and collapsing. So I just literally watch the ball on my foot, don't even know where the goal is, and end up drilling one top corner to go 2-2 in the first game back against Auckland City. Again, in that flash moment where I'm letting all this frustration out, run to the 8 or 9 Auckland City fans that have been hammering me for the whole game. Give them the wanker sign.
It's a great photo of that. I think it's Aaron Scott, sort of, I don't know, he's holding you back.
Or joining them. Great photo.
Have you got the racing?
No, that was a previous era. Yeah, the racing stripe mullet. But then again, to sum up my playing career, 2-2, take that at home. 6 minutes later, about the 87th minute, Auckland City get a very dubious handball outside the box that I'm, again, apologies to Nick if it wasn't you, but I think Nick Waldron might have been the referee. No doubt he's listening, Nick. If it wasn't you, I apologise. But
friend of the show.
And get a penalty. My one time backup, Brian Little, steps up and strokes the penalty in, and we lose 3-2. And it was all for nothing.
Gold.
When is the...
The car park.
I'll see you in the car park.
So this is the second prologue, second time we played in that season, which you were playing. Again, you're...
He's pointing to me now, not Shay.
Didn't make the squad for that game. But,
unlucky.
Yeah, we played him. Funnily enough, I play in central midfield and Keryn Jordan's playing in central midfield. Dropped deeper, directly up against him all game. Made a real point. Not going to lose my head. Kind of keep things, blah, blah, blah. We actually did all right. We played well. It was 0-0 going into about the 70th, 75th minute. I think we'd missed a couple of chances. Probably maybe you for one, Steve. I'll put that out there, but we can check back. And of all people, against the run of play, Joel Matthews ends up down the side of the box. Don't think Joel had ever had a shot on goal in his career, let alone scored a goal. And must have been a cross, but ends up like swerving one top corner for them to go 1-0 up.
Past Danny Robinson?
Past Danny Robinson. So we're 1-0 down, and then I think we might have conceded another penalty, and it's suddenly 2-0 down, and there's 3 minutes to go. Now, I've been quite mature here, and I've held this all in. Kieran's been subbed, and again, I apologise for this, and I wouldn't advise any of my players to go through this process, but I've essentially now thought, right, I'm going to try and do something here in the last 3 minutes, get this all out of my system. And I just remember Grant Young picking the ball up down the sideline and running with the ball right in front of the dugouts. And just me seeing Red hounding him down the sideline. Bad tackle. Which I know I'm going to get sent off for. Again, Youngie was actually a top man. No issue with Youngie. Good guy. But it was immaturity. It was stupidity. But it basically incites an all-in brawl off the benches. I get pegged in the middle of the... Me and Youngie comes back at me, as you'd expect. Me and him are face-to-face. Everyone crowds in. I'm now pinned in the middle. And I actually take a couple of like straight rights to the back of the head, which I'm pretty sure is Alex Federidis.
Yeah.
I can't prove this. So if he wants to write in and confirm whether he did catch me a couple of times...
We'll tag him in the show notes.
Yeah. I know I'm getting sent off. The brawl, a lot of handbags, but everyone's in... Yeah, it's all come out. And when the brawl dissipates, it suddenly goes quiet. And one guy from above the dugout at Kiwitea Street, in plain silence, only in New Zealand football where there's not a big crowd, goes, "You're a fucking wanker, Wilkinson. You fucking wanker." And like...
Made some strong points.
Yeah. Which again, 100% was probably merited. But it caught my attention so clearly. Everyone can hear it. And again, with everything that's gone on and the heat of the moment, I can't get to him because he's up off the pitch. So I have no
recourse.
I have no weapon but my words. And I choose to use the words, "How about I see you in the car park, old man?" To which, the moment they leave my mouth, I know, and I just want to grab them back in. But I can't. And I think at the time, I remember, despite the moment, I remember looking and seeing Joel Matthews giggling at the, what I've just said. And to this day, I have people that were involved or that I know still throwing that "why don't we see you in the car park" comment back at me.
Where were you during all of this, Steve? Do you recall? I mean, because pretty sure you didn't remember that you played with Sam National League. So what's your recollection of...
I think I was on the bench for some reason, because I do, I definitely
You started, you might have come off.
I might have come off, yeah. Dodgy hands late in the game, you know, good for 70. But I remember vividly the guy having a go at you. And I was just loving it, to be honest. 21-year-old Wilkie, so I would have been 19. Thinking, I love that we are going to ride on this for the rest of our lives.
Yeah. And we have. Yeah. We still do. I wasn't even there. And I reference it.
I get Luke Finley, who was one of our imports, good friend, colourful character. Will,
oh, come on, mate.
sorry to Luke if that came out the wrong way. Will still, every 2 or 3 years, just send me a single Facebook message saying, "How about I see you in the car park," to remind me of that very moment. So, yeah.
Oh, that's great. That is great. A real great snapshot of the early, like the 20s Wilkinson, well, the early 20s Wilkinson. But I want to just take a little step back, because I want to get to how this character evolved. And I think we need to go back to when you were aged around 9 or 10, because you were the star of the Wilkinson Method, which was for those who don't know, a lads and dads coaching video set out for parents who didn't know how to coach, some drills and things like that. So, Sam Wilkinson aged, and maybe 10, maybe 11, I think, undisputedly, was the best technical footballer in the country by quite a mile. He practiced juggling every day, he had the step overs, he had the Cruyff turns, he had it all. Play of the tournament, we had Rose Bowl, I remember it all. So, I just want you to talk us through where you went from that technical, you had it all, it looked like you had it all, and I know you went in and did some trials and things like that, and you came out the other end and you ended up at Auckland City, which is nothing to frown at, you know. It's a good effort, but perhaps from the expectations of that 10-year-old footballer, perhaps didn't quite go as far as you would have wanted to. So talk us through how you became that technically proficient and where perhaps it didn't quite go to plan.
Yeah, it's a question I lie awake at night very often thinking about. So how did I get to that point? Well, the short answer is I had a dad who was not just a coach, but I guess a very thoughtful and innovative coach. Had a real passion for, I guess, development and skill acquisition, as well as just coaching in general. So I most definitely got a huge head start, particularly in this country, on kids, because I guess to use the phrase, technically I was incredibly sound because I'd done all this practice and I'd had like a dad as a coach correcting things and what have you. What I would also add to that is I didn't at 5 or 6 have a huge passion for football, but at around 8 or 9 something flicked, and I loved football. So on top of having a dad that was a coach and would do a lot of extra training with me, I just always had a ball and would kick against the wall, would play every lunchtime.
Was that Italia 90 that was kind of the catalyst?
No, that was probably a little bit earlier. Funnily enough, it was the 91 season, and I'll tell you what it was. The games, Premier League, used to be on Sky, and I remember getting up and watching Man City, who had become my team, beat Liverpool 2-1, which is a big deal back then. Here's for your memory, I think David White scored the winner. And it all coming about the same time that watching football, watching the highlights. I loved watching football. I suddenly had a little group of mates at Hillcrest Primary that played. So I was just, I spent my evenings at Waikato United trainings kicking a ball. So I was just never away from a ball. So I think all those things put together, the one thing I've probably always had as well, I was very two-footed. Dad was adamant everything was both feet, which again is something that stuck with me very much. So that those factors created that, to the point where I do remember as a 12-year-old going across to the UK on a trip with Dad and going and training with Crewe Alexander's
Dario Greedy
Academy. Dario took the session, funnily enough. What a come across some trouble himself in recent years, but talk about a student of the game. It was the manager taking the under 13 session, and in that session, that was Dad wanted to see what I was like compared to those kids, and I was still good. I remember thinking, oh, I'm still really good here, and I mean, I think Dario had sort of said, what are you doing, Roger? Are you moving back here? And he was like, no, we want to stay, blah, blah, blah. So at that point, I think I was genuinely good. Then I think it was a number of things. I think I didn't develop at all athletically. I was a late developer, but I was never dynamic or explosive. I could
sort born of, with the handbrake on.
Born as, with the handbrake on.
Is what a lot of right, people yeah. were saying.
Or as as one American import used to say, I'd run with a fridge on my back would be the phrase. And look, what I would also add to that, and it's I was probably very manufactured in a way, and Dad always had this big thing about trying to develop me to play the game a bit differently to everyone else. So like as a 10-year-old, I was trying to flick it up and volley it in and things like that and doing little reverse passes. And as the game got closer to senior football and became a lot more functional, probably a lot of the stuff I was trying to do got lost in the game. And I wasn't overly functional. I wasn't get it, give it, arrive in the box, score. I was always trying to be a clever player and do things a bit different. So yeah, I probably lost a bit of effectiveness as I got towards the cut and thrust of senior football, and maybe I didn't have the smarts to adapt my game. Add on top of that, like I said, to go and play at a high level athletically, I was never great. And then I got at about 16, and everyone's got a sob story, but very much like yourself, I started getting, I had a chronic thigh injury that I missed a lot of football for about 12 to 18 months at 16, and just found by the time I was back playing regularly, probably all the things that had made me a bit different and made me really good when I was 12 or 13 weren't as effective. I wasn't able to impact them as much on the game. That was probably it. I don't think it's as easy as saying it's one thing in particular. So I did go back to England as a 16-year-old. Found that really hard. I was a dweeby little kid from New Zealand that was skinny, naive, and first club I went into was Crystal Palace, and training with a bunch of like streetwise South London kids, got eaten alive, spent about 6 months at Birmingham City, and would show some good things, wasn't horrific, but was never impacting trainings or games enough to genuinely be looked at, and in all honesty was not probably tough enough or driven enough to really go over there and force myself into games and stand out a lot. So it was probably a number of factors, I guess, that led to the drop off.
Was Rog like quite forceful, and not forceful is the wrong word, but was he desperate for you to try and make it as a pro?
Yeah, 100% he was. And yeah, no, he was forceful. No, I don't think in a bad way. I wanted it. I wanted to be a player, you know. I loved the game. I had made it clear I wanted to try and be a professional. So yeah, he was definitely, he wasn't always the Rog you see now where it's joke a minute and laugh a minute. He was, I wind him up now, you know, I sort of say like, I don't know if at under nines playing for Hillcrest Juniors against Marist, I needed like an hour dressing down in the car on the way home about like my tracking back and things like this. But it all came from the right place. And yeah, he was 100% desperate for me. So, and I think because he essentially developed me, he probably had more appreciation for some of the things I would try and do on the pitch than others, and was probably equally frustrated at times that I would get overlooked for things, and maybe other people didn't value, rightly or wrongly, didn't value the way I played the game. So yeah, that he was 100%, you know, desperate for me to be a player.
Sorry, Steve, you might want to ask a question, but at what age were you when he was technical director at NZF? And
I was about 13.
Oh, okay, so it's pre under 17s teams and anything like
yeah,
that.
Yeah, so I could never ride off his coattails. So I played in an under 16 New Zealand group. I think Mick Waite took us, and we went to Napier tournament, and we were supposed to play a couple of friendlies the following January, but they got canned. But I was a year young, or I was the early year of the cycle for the 99 World Cup.
That was my year.
Yeah, again, two of us, don't know how we didn't get looking, but yeah. But again, was underdeveloped for my own age, so I was never gonna, you know, rightly so, wouldn't have been in the mix for that, playing a year up essentially. So yeah, and then again, when I came back from England, I went to a few training camps for the under 20s. Ken Creswell was the coach. Again, didn't make the squad that went to the qualifiers, that I think included Ross McKenzie again, and I think they actually lost to Fiji and were one of the first age group teams to not get through to the playoff with Australia.
Hopefully get some stories about that tour. Yeah, that's right.
I think there was a lot of talk of...
It was Stu Hogan then.
Yeah, and Nathan Strom, and I a lot of talk about the boys spending a lot of sunbathing time out the back of the hotel in preparation for games, but we'll save that one for...
So just to fast forward a little bit, so you did retire or stop playing at an early age, and I know that even when you were coaching Melville, I think Bruce made a few observations that you could still do a job in the midfield, and you'd been retired for a few years earlier than that. What do you put that down to? Is that a fact of you'd burnt out as a player because of too much football too young, or is it just a case of you weren't able to do the things that you wanted, you knew you should do as a coach? Is it that kind of coach player brain colliding?
I think honestly I'd probably begun to move away from playing before I'd really thrown myself into coaching. I developed a bit of a love-hate relationship with the game. I'd got to the point I was playing National League and Winter League here, and I liked playing well. I didn't love just playing, and I was probably in a couple of environments, without being overly disrespectful to any clubs or coaches, where we weren't training that well. I knew I wasn't sharp, fit. I wasn't playing at a level I liked to play at. And just got to the point where I didn't enjoy it. I didn't enjoy going to the training sessions. I didn't enjoy playing probably below the level I wanted to play at, in terms of my own performance.
So what age did you stop playing?
So it was about 26. It wasn't a plan. Previous guest Shay Bunce had taken over Waikato FC. I'd made my mind up in the January I was going to go back to England, and was going to play possibly, but because I was leaving in January, I wasn't going to play that first half of the National League season. I was just going to work and then go to England. And then Buncey got the job. He was a mate, went a long way back with Buncey. So I said, yeah, look, I'll play, try and help him out, which was the wrong decision because my heart wasn't in it, and I was only trying to do it to help him a little bit. So I played a few games, but by my own admission, was not fully committed to the level I should have been. Went to England and was still thinking about maybe if it was going to be a better scene, I'd maybe go and play there and teach. And then essentially very early on went and did some work for Dad's company in the Midlands coaching, and got offered a part-time role coaching at West Bromwich Albion that basically took out my weekends and evenings. And I at that point kind of it just became, look, coaching was something I was pursuing more. So it had been coming. I'd lost the enjoyment. I was just more frustrated and angry playing than I was enjoying it. And I think when the coaching came along, that probably gave me a valid reason to focus on that and stop playing. And
Well, we're going to get into the coaching stuff. I just want to dig around in the personality and the temperament and how that's perhaps changed over the years. Because my experiences with you, the early years, the sort of teenager and the early 20s you talked about, and I think Steve Williams might have actually coined it, you were Jack the Lad. It was you loved to drink, you loved a night out, you know, a life of the party, it was a million miles an hour. But then there came a point, and I'm not sure exactly when it was, and it might have been early 20s, it might have been after the Auckland City, where you decided alcohol wasn't for you, and there were a lot of tough situations where there was a lot of peer pressure from your group, and it was you were probably the one who made the call the earliest that no, I'm just not going to drink anymore. And maybe it's because the way you didn't like the way that you were on the booze, or maybe it was another reason. But then your personality now, and I'm gonna compare you to someone who you might perhaps not like the comparison, but when I sat with Anthony Hudson and I sit with you, a lot of times it's a very similar intensity, and that intensity is so single-minded about football. And I think really successful people, not saying Hudson is by any means really successful person, but needs that single-mindedness and that ambition and that desire and that intensity. And I see that in you now, but perhaps didn't have that earlier in those sort of teenage early 20 years. And so how do you think you've evolved, and where does alcohol, I mean, we're having a beer tonight, which just wouldn't have been on the cards even sort of 5-6 years ago, so how does that all sort of come together?
Deep question. Good though. I think if I'm honest, I think that side, night out with the lads, that's probably the side that isn't really my personality. Where I think I can trace this back to is I had that very singular focus through high school, went over to England, tunnel vision on wanting to be a footballer. So I was never really the kid at school that went to parties and drank, never touched alcohol, you know. So I was always that quite intense focus, and, you know, went to England at 16 for 2 years. So when all my mates were going to the ball and doing this and doing that, I was in England catching trains around England, staying in strange people's houses as digs at clubs and trialing, and quite a tough time, but was just everything was on that. So I didn't have a great social life. Felt, you know, as you would at that age, feel a bit like I'm making all these sacrifices to chase this, wasn't getting signed, wasn't going well, here's all my mates back in New Zealand having a great time, I'm missing out on life, you know. Got to sort of 18 and headed back to New Zealand and probably thought, right, I can be a lad now, you know. Went into the New Zealand senior football scene at 18, where we, you know, me, you and Maney and Coombsy, and it was very much, particularly in a Hamilton team, it was play a game, have beers afterwards with the lads. There was that team bonding. There was a lot of bus trips, great atmosphere on the bus trips. You know, no different than anyone else had done. And suddenly it's like the shackles are off here. And I'd always probably had that lad banter to my personality. But obviously you have a couple of drinks and it goes up a few notches. And coming back from England, where the humour and the banter is quite cutting and you know, quite barbed, and suddenly being that lad after a few beers on the bus and everyone thinks it's hilarious, and that probably egged that side of me on. And I think it was just a case of getting that out of my system eventually. You know, I like everyone, would play football, would train during the week, and then would go out on a Saturday and be Jack the Lad. But got younger than that, probably got to about like 21, 22, and just sort of started thinking there's got to be a little bit more to this. And it wasn't going out as regularly. We'd go out 2 or 3 times a year, less and less. And then, yeah, got to the point where the coaching filled the void that pursuing a career as a player had once filled. And I am quite a, I'm an all or nothing character. So I'm either the Jack the Lad that's first one on the dance floor, last one off it, or I'm the guy that don't go anywhere near it and stay at home and I'm in bed by nine watching coaching videos to try and study for the next game. And that is my personality. So I guess it manifests itself in different ways. And I'd like to think as I get older, I try and get a little bit of balance sometimes and temper that. But yeah, that's who I am as a person.
And what about the short fuse? We've talked about it already in the Auckland City dressing room as a 21-year-old. I have seen it as recently as this season on the sidelines for Melville. There's been a few flare-ups, I think. Kevin Fallon might have been involved. There was one at Wanderers, you know, bits and pieces, Hawani Edwards. That's obviously part of your success as well, because you've got that drive, that intensity I was talking about. Mm. You know, you are prepared to put people in their place when they need to be. It can be seen as a negative. Mm. So is that a part of your professional life that you're seeking to curb, and why? Has that always been the way you've been?
No, it hasn't. I definitely get that, I'd say, from my dad. My mum is a lot more, not placid, she's quite strong, but she's probably a lot more thoughtful with her responses. And it's funny, because as a kid, dad would constantly be getting in arguments with people and fights with people. And I, as a kid, used to hate that confrontation and think like, why is he doing this? Why can't he just walk away? And just found as I got older, that's kind of his personality coming out in me. Look, I think my take on it is, I don't think I'm not out there headbutting people or anything like that. You know, I'm when it's something I care about, I'm quite
just my mind flashback to Gower Park round one.
Again. That was more of a chest bump. When it's something I care about, going back to the first story, family, you know, I'm fiercely loyal to family, so that if I feel like someone's coming for a family member, that can light the fuse. Football is my life, so if it's something around that or something I'm putting all my energy and time into, you will see football provoke extreme reactions from me. I don't think I cross the line too much. I think I'm quite good at, if I have maybe gone a little bit too far fronting up to that, to go back, I should probably put this in, like, to the classic example of me, the Keryn Jordan story is years later when I was living in England, I found out he was ill with cancer. I reached out to him and sent him a message and sort of said like, hey, look, you know, I know you're not thinking of me at the moment, but I just wanted to wish you all the best and no hard feelings. And I'd seen his son play in a tournament in England. I said, I think your boy's a super player, blah, blah, blah. So I don't think I'm a...
I think you're very good at that.
I don't hold grudges. I'm a passionate person about things I care about. There are some things in life that probably should provoke a reaction from me that if I don't really care about it, I couldn't care less and I'll let things go. But if it's something I think I've been wronged, or someone I care about's been wronged, or I've got quite a keen sense of justice with certain things, then that is a side of my personality I most definitely get from the old man, and it has come out more as I've gotten older. And I'm probably at a point where I'm less, I think this is a good thing, I'm less bothered about what people think about me. I'm quite happy to just say what I think. If I reflect and think I've overstepped the mark, I'll seek that person out, but if it offends a few people, I'm okay with that these days.
Talk to me about the relationship with Kevin Fallon, because I understand you guys are on good terms,
yep,
but over the years there have been a number of blow-ups. Where's that come from? Is it just two hard-headed guys going at it?
I wouldn't say there's been a number of blow-ups. Ironically, it's funny how history repeats himself, that Dad and Kevin have huge respect for each other, but clashed constantly as opposing coaches. There's a classic story of Rog dousing Kevin in an ice bucket of water at Muir Park, back and forth, and Although, to be fair, not many people, you wouldn't miss too much with Kev back in his heyday. But it was
one. Is that why you waited till he was 70 plus?
Yeah, you got to pick your battles, man. You know your game. It was one game. And look, what I would say is I have got huge respect for the old school and that era of coach because I grew up watching these people. So, funnily enough, like in the programme notes when we played Manukau that season, I think I'd been really complimentary and it was all genuine because I'd grown up watching Kevin's teams battle dads and he was like an icon to me. But I view the game as slightly different to the rest of life. For me, it's a little bit all's fair in love and war during 90 minutes and I don't hold many grudges on what goes on the touchline. I just think it's fair game. Now, again, to give you the backstory, Kev's teams have a history of being quite combative, tough teams. We were a youngish team. We'd made a real point in the build-up about protecting the home ground advantage. Don't come and let them bully, dominate physically. We'd spoken about getting on top of the ref, staying on top of the ref. So I'd made a real point. I'd said to Maney, look, I'll go and stand and get after the ref a little bit early, make sure he's lenient on us or try and influence it where I can. And didn't expect this from Kevin with his track record, but very much like my dad, he's a different character to what he was probably 20 years ago. So there'd been a couple of tough tackles from our end, funnily enough. I think Aaron Scott had gone and put someone through the advertising boards early doors. What an arsehole. And then anyway, I'd basically been going at the ref a few times. Come on, ref. Just trying to influence him. And I thought I'd heard someone go like, sit down, you fucking idiot. And I kind of, in the heat of the moment, hadn't taken much notice of it and ignored it. Another something, said something to the ref and very clearly heard, sit down and shut the fuck up, you fucking idiot. So I turned around and looked at him and he said it again. And I thought, and again, I'm in battle mode and I'm particularly wound up because it was a big game and we needed to win. So again, you talk about crossing over that line. I think I just came out with something like, why don't you shut the fuck up, you silly old.
Yep.
See you next Christmas.
Yep.
Silly words, but nothing. There's no real thought behind that. It's just whatever spits out of some of my brain. Now, what I didn't legislate for was 73-year-old Kevin Fallon bouncing out of his seat and come charging towards me saying, I think his exact words were, I'll still scrap you now, you wanker. So, again, you talk about those moments and it's amazing how quick your brain can process things. I'm now thinking, what's my play here? Do I lead in with something? And then I've initiated a fight with a 73-year-old who, don't get me wrong, in his heyday could have wiped the floor with me most definitely, but is...
Or possibly now.
Or even money.
And the other side of the thing, do I just stand here and possibly let Kev come and like nut me and then I've been...
Floored by a 73-year-old.
What's worse here? And I'm basically trying to process this information as he's charging towards me and... Thank God his assistant has managed to bound up and get in front of Kev and I'm now in my happy place of having someone in between us. So it's just pure handbags and we're now just, you wanker, no, you're aware. And anyway, we lost 3-2 in the end. Should have won. I think George Curry's missed a one-on-one at 1-0.
Sorry, I shouldn't say fault, but.
Yeah, no, it was his fault.
It was his fault.
And I think actually Liam Hayes got caught on the edge of our box, gave it away, and that went 1-0 down. So I'm not sure if Liam Hayes is listening, but
didn't ask any questions.
Maybe he should have just stayed out of it. But
he's quite passive. Normally.
Yeah, but so we lost. And look, when we lose, I went up and shook his hand and said, "Well done." So no carry on. I did the speech. Said congrats to Kev, blah, blah, blah. And I think he actually had a bit of a pop at us in the speech, funnily enough, about new age coaches and blah, blah, blah. And then he does his blog, which again is a great read, but had a pop at me in the blog as well on the Monday. And that was where I thought, oh, come on, look, a coach. I was a bit disappointed because he was a coach I looked up to. And I thought, for someone that's done what he's done in the game, I'm a young coach, whether I was in the right or in the wrong. I thought he, of all people, could understand you're on edge, blah, blah, blah. And was quite disappointed. And we played them later in the season. We barely spoke. Again, I had to go and shake his hand. They beat us 1-0. But was quite disappointed, really, that the relationship had got to that point. Because it wasn't. And the only issue I'd had was that he'd sort of carried it on beyond the 90 minutes. And thankfully, I think when we played them this season, Dad caught up with him in the club rooms. And whilst he didn't directly apologise to me, he said to Dad, look, I felt bad. I shouldn't have said that in the blog. You know, like, we obviously went back and forth, blah, blah. And I was really pleased with that, because when we played them the second time, I had a good chat with them before the game. And like I said, you know, I don't want to, I'm not naturally looking for confrontation or to fall out with people. But again, especially people that I've looked up to, and he's someone that I've got great respect for. So
Let's bring you up to 2019, because you're coaching. Let's get into your coaching. So you did 3 or 4 years in the UK, grinding away in terrible weather, freezing cold, training every night, you know, sort of earning your stripes as a coach. And you made the decision to move back to New Zealand, looking around, searching for the right club to land at. It ended up being at Hamilton at Melville. So you were there 3 years. And in the last year, which was this season, it was a really tough start to the campaign. And I've talked about this before, but I remember being at the cafe across the road from Gower Park about 9 games into the season, and Melville had drawn 1, lost 8 or something like that. It was a really 1-1.
You're the media guy.
1-1, lost 9.
We definitely won.
We'd 1-1, lost 4 when we met, and then we lost that afternoon.
We'd gone
1-5 as the start to the season.
But I would classify that meetup as perhaps seeing you at your lowest. You had invested everything into this club. You talk about, you know, dollars per hour and your hourly rate, and how often you were down at the club doing trainings in the mornings, in the afternoon, putting so much work in. You weren't seeing the results on the field, and it was unlucky a lot of the time. It was 93rd minute losers, and, you know, up 2-0 and losing 3-2, but it had taken its toll on you. And you were sitting there and you were sort of saying, well, am I looking at another career? Like, it was literally that point where you were, I don't know how honest you were, but you were saying, you know, I could be a salesman making a good wage and have a really sort of...
Vodafone it was, wasn't it?
Have a really good life, and here I am struggling away, and it just seems like it's all uphill, and what's the whole sort of point? So things obviously turned around, and that second half of that season was incredible, and I think a lot of that was due to the work you and Manny put in. You know, you made the Chatham Cup final, you had an incredible end to the season. I think you finished fifth in the league?
We were fifth, but I think we were a point off second or third, and we were having to play our goalkeeper coach in the last game. So yeah. I think we were top two or three side by the end of the season.
But on the back of that success, you've picked up a gig with the Wellington Phoenix. You're obviously very highly regarded in the football community. So take me back to that specific meeting and how serious you were about potentially exploring other opportunities, and where you are now and how you got there.
Yeah, I don't think I was that. So it was incredible frustration. Weird little backstory that probably set off a lot of this was I'd had to give my dog away, which...
Oh yeah,
had just happened at the start of the season. So we'd had a dog that I'd ended up being allergic to. I'm a big dog guy, love dogs, and
do you like dogs?
Yeah, yeah, likes dogs. Not a particularly sentimental person, but found suddenly dogs were my kryptonite, and I basically had to give away, all because of me, this dog. That hit me quite hard, which sounds a bit naff now I'm saying that. But
I remember, thinking back to it, I remember that, and I remember thinking, that I know Wilky as this personality and thinking how much you were actually affected by
it. Yeah. It was like tough.
He was in bits.
So that had happened, which knocked me about more, maybe more than it should have done, more than I thought it would have done, but it did. And then coupled to that, those first six games, we were, it's easy to say this, we were unlucky. We were 100% unlucky. We lost to Wanderers in the 94th minute, in the first game of the season, which was a tough one. It was a big occasion. I believe we dominated the game.
If the grass was shorter, do you think we would have won?
These are all the little backstories of working at club football. The grass don't get mowed the day before. I'm fuming about that before the game. And these are the things no one ever sees that lead you to being in these positions where you're ready to smash the table up at LK Coffee on a Saturday morning. But we'd had a win. We'd lost in the 94th minute to Eastern Suburbs at home with a splinter team, schoolboys on the pitch when they were still basically trotted out half their National League team. 2 days later, we lost to Western Springs, being 1-0 up in the 80th minute. Our best and most reliable player underhits a bat. So it was like, what you saw there was, why is this? I don't feel like I've got, we're working hard. We're addressing the things that have gone wrong. The lads are training well. We're playing well at times. That was my first real slump as a head coach. You know, although we didn't get promoted the first season, we lost five games in 2 years. So I'd never had like a run of losses. And I just couldn't, you know, looking back now, it was a good process to go through. Added to give away the dog, I'm a bit down. And it was just, what you saw was just incredible frustration, looking for an outlet, looking for something to blame. I turn on myself, believe it or not, more than anything. So my mindset when it's not going well is, I'm a shit coach, I'm clueless, I don't know what I'm doing. You know, that's the anger, and I have anger with myself. So hence why when things don't go well, I'm messaging you guys at 4 a.m. we need to do this, we need to look at this player, and you like thinking like, what the fuck is wrong with this guy? And it was tough, and I think the biggest thing was, and again, good learning for me as a coach that wants to be successful, that there are times when you have as a coach no control over the outcome. And it just so happens there was four or five games, which is an unlucky run, where they were all own goals in the last minute, we miss a penalty, they run down the other end and score, which exacerbated the situation. So again, that kind of self-loathing leads me to, I'd be better off doing something else, you know, blah blah blah. And that was what you saw. That I don't think it was a genuine threat, it was just incredible frustration. And funnily enough, I leaned incredibly heavily on the old man during that time, because he's been through this, and he was saying, it'll turn, you just got to keep doing the right things, it'll turn, I've been there, it'll turn. I couldn't see it at the time as a young coach, but it did turn. And
but it didn't, it didn't turn eventually, it got worse. And the was it the Burkhart?
No, that was the only hung so spray? Yeah, so we went away to East Coast Bays and won
a cup game,
and then we came back home and lost 2-1 to Only Hunger. Very similar, we're in the game, late goals. And I'd always been, I think I'd been quite gentle with the players up until that point, very mindful of what young players are like. And I just thought, as a young team, we weren't as resilient as we should have been. We'd come from a league where we pretty much had everything our own way. And I wouldn't do this every week, but I thought, and again, it was a heated spray, but it was planned. I'd said to Maney when we were on the pitch, him and our little thing, like, I'm gonna get after him here, and I'm really gonna come for him. And I said, look, I'm quite happy if a couple of them walk away from here and say it's too hard, we'll take that hit, because something's got to change, just in terms of the resilience and the I guess the ability to grind out results. So I went in, and I was raging from the result and the the similarity in the way we've been losing. And yeah, I delivered what I think one of my finest hair dryer moments I've ever delivered. And it just all came out off the cuff. And I remember walking out and I could actually feel the vein in the top of my head. I could physically feel it throbbing. Yeah, and funnily enough, from that moment, although we signed a Welsh boy, Craig Pritchard, who had a huge impact on our team, but funnily enough, from that moment, we beat Waitakere away the following week, we beat Birkenhead, and we won in the cup all before he got. And a couple of the players, the good, loyal lads that have been your Luke Searles, funnily enough, came up to me the day after and said, I think that was exactly what we needed. We need to kick up, you know, we need to that jolt. And
yeah.
So I would argue it was justified.
So a season of highs and lows, the roller coaster was complete by the fairy tale run, making the Chatham Cup final, being 1-0 up and losing 3-1. Familiar story for you. How was your emotions? 3-2. Mm. Yeah, late. Aaron Scott. Yeah, you forget about that. How were your emotions after that? How much did it mean to you to win the Chatham Cup final, and how were you feeling for those hours after the game?
Yeah, low. I think knowing that we were leaving, that would have been the perfect ending. Particularly, I think we were so good in the first half, so comfortable. Just a little bit of disbelief with the sending off and the manner of losing. I think the sending off and just the way the goals went in, just couldn't quite comprehend what had happened, which then turned to anger. And yeah, it was, football doesn't follow the script, you know, how often you want the nice, we leave and we all walk off as champions, but that doesn't happen. But yeah, I was gutted. Probably the saving grace was I started at the Phoenix the following Thursday, so I very quickly had to get in my car, drive to Wellington and get on the grass, which allowed me to move on really quickly. I haven't watched the game back to this day, which if I was staying at Melville, I would have been watching that game a number of times. But I was mortified. Funnily enough, I was angry. I came in the change room and I was angry. And then I think it was Azza came up to me and I could see he was crying. And I think he said, like, sorry, gaffer, or something like that. And that anger then turned to sorrow, and that set me off. And I just luckily had a towel, and I think I just put the towel over my head, and I think I had a little whinge to myself there, and then I dried my eyes and got on with it, and we got on the bus and came home. So yeah, I was gutted. I want to be a winner, you know. I pride myself on trying to help young players. My background was in development, but I believe first team football is about winning, and I wanted to win. And as much as I think we did a good job at Melville, the fact we didn't win that silverware, for me, it's not a huge success story. And so that was really disappointing for me.
So talk us through the decision to leave Melville. Was how early in the piece had you made the decision that 3 years was enough for you at Melville, and what were your reasons for leaving?
Yeah, it was probably about two-thirds of the way through the season. I was worn out from, I think, and a lot of people don't realise this, like, first season, we both worked full-time jobs and did everything.
You and Manny.
You and me and Michael. Michael probably won't mind me saying this, but I obviously probably, my nature, my personality, I don't have kids, took on, especially in year two and three, took on a bit more responsibility or put a little bit more hands-on time, which, again, I was happy to do, and that's the strength of our friendship and relationship, that there was never any like bad beef if I was there a bit more than him. But like I'll speak for myself. I was running myself into the ground. So the first year I'd worked full time doing relief teaching, coached in the mornings, coached in the evenings, coached all weekend. The last 2 years I went part time running a school football program and was still coaching two mornings a week at the club, five evenings at the club, coaching at the school program. So I was very exhausted. It wasn't a sustainable model, and I was so determined, going back to your point, to if it wasn't going my way, I'm gonna make this work. I'm gonna do more. I'm gonna be there more. I'll, you know, that's how I deal with things. I'll get hold of it and I'll make it happen. That's kind of my mentality. But I think the thing that led us to time to move on was just we came into the club and offered us, you know, I think you teed it up. We probably offered ourselves to the club more than the club said, here's our plans. We want to achieve this. These guys can help us do it. So all the initiatives were us driving them as opposed to the club saying, we want to do this. Can you guys get this going? And probably naively, I thought, if we get some of this going, get the first team training four times a week, get an academy going, get social media going, all this sort of stuff, they're going to buzz off this and everyone will get on board and everyone will pitch in and we'll grow this club. And not only did that not happen, by year three, with all we'd done and all the time we'd put in, just still having arguments about why the first team should be allowed to use the number two training pitch. Not train on the number one pitch, the number two training pitch. Well, the old boys want a game on there on Friday, so we don't want you to train there Thursday. You know, I would walk down on a Wednesday night and see 100 kids in the academy, some really good young players, the future of the club, and think, this is amazing. And then come in on a Thursday and there would be an email, why did the under 12s train on pitch 5 instead of pitch 6? What's going on there? And that on its own, but 3 years of that kind of, that was the thinking of the club. They hadn't come on board with our ambition and where we wanted to take it. And it wore me down. And I thought, I can't, you can lead a horse to water, but you can't make it drink it. And there's some really great people at Melville. Someone like your dad was a tremendous worker and help to us. But there was a lot of people that just didn't buy into what we were doing. Some that just refused to help with it, and some that probably actively tried to block some of the stuff we were doing. And after a time, I think we just realised this isn't the vehicle to take us or to build the club where we want it to be. And we can't keep, I can't keep bleeding myself dry here when it's, I'm going to keep having these same issues and conversations in 5-10 years. So it wasn't a finished project for me, and there's a little bit of disappointment.
Did you and Maney arrive at this decision together? Or was one,
well, I think he was probably there a little bit earlier, to be honest. Maney's situation is different because he had a second kid. I'll put everything on hold for football. That might have to change come Jan 4th. but that is my mindset. If I don't, I mean, like, again, I don't want to paint this out like a sob story, but like, we got the first season, we got $10,000 for everything we did from the club. The second season, I paid my money to other coaches. So I worked for free because my mindset was never about, I've got to feed the family, or I've got to pay the, it was, this is what I want to achieve. I've got to make this happen. And if I can take my money and give it to Rog to come and work with the under 14s, that's moving towards that goal. I couldn't give a shit. I'll live off 30 grand a year. So that was always, and I was in the position to do that. Maney wasn't. So Maney was still putting an awful lot of work. He's dealing with kids. He's working full time. He's rock climbing in the evenings. He's fishing on the weekends. And something had to give. So he'd got there earlier than me. I was still a little bit like, no, we can make this work. We can make this work. And then I think, I don't know, there was a particular moment, but it was probably on a Monday morning, waking up to some form of email from YBOP saying, Club X has complained because your under 11 pitch is 5 steps too short, so we're docking them the points and you'll be fined for that. And I just thought, yeah, it's time to look for some. I need a new, this is not going to be the right vehicle, time to move on. So yeah,
you mentioned working with Michael really closely. I mean, he will be your brother-in-law,
yeah,
is that right?
Yeah,
on the 4th of January.
Best man
at your wedding.
Kia ora, Michael.
That relationship of, I mean, I like to think I'm one of your quite good mates. Yeah. I was team manager for 2 years, yeah, 1.5 maybe. Yeah.
We cobbled the actual time together.
Yeah. Like working with mates in that project, did that hamper what you wanted to do sometimes because maybe you didn't feel like you could hammer us or push us for fear of losing like a friendship or us falling out?
I think if anything, I felt I could ride you as hard as I wanted, knowing that you're a mate and you can't leave me.
Don't leave me.
I mean, I don't know. You could probably answer this more. The relationship, I think you two are a lot more tolerant of when I'm intolerable because you're my mate. And you two, I'm sure at times thought, just let him vent and then he'll be fine. And
It's quite interesting after a Melville loss, because I'd be there watching and doing media and things, and it got to the point where I knew these last minute losing goals or whatever, just don't approach him, just don't bother. But Maney would be more affable and he'd ever, you know, play with his kids or whatever. Wilkie would just be head down. You'd leave him and you don't talk to him in the club rooms afterwards, and then a couple of hours later he'll sort of settle down.
There was a period where we talk about not going out and drinking.
Yeah, we went out.
We would go, like, every time we lost, I would go out with Sam and we would go out drinking.
Needed a outlet.
And that's fine. And again, to take that friendship step one dimension further, where you were coaching a good friend, Stephen Holloway, and have to make the decision
of his career.
To end his career, basically. How was that? Elephant in the room.
I broke my first rule. I said when I was going into a club, I'd never sign lads that I was matey with or had played with, because I was still youngish and I thought, I don't want this awkwardness. They've known me as a mate. But to be honest, we'd probably missed out on a couple of players. We knew we were a bit light. There was potential of Stephen moving back, and we were sort of like, look, this is a no-brainer really. We'll deal with that side of it, working with a mate. There was a couple of awkward... I feel like I want to preface this, because Stephen made a point. We've always been quite... I'd say we're quite competitive as mates.
Yep.
Like, that's been the relationship.
The 1 kilometre time trial.
Yeah, but even as kids, I remember, I think we were always quite competitive. But what I will say about Stephen is that Stephen, 3 or 4 years prior in his prime... We'd have won the league that first year and probably not lost a game had we have had him up front. So that was, now, by his own admission, I think, correct me if I'm wrong,
I thought I was still a very good player.
Well, you were. He was breaking down. Your body was breaking down, and I think we'd all hoped that we could probably, and we did to an extent at times, milk your experience and your streetwise nature of your game to get one more season. You know, it's that Moneyball scene with David Justice where we want to eat the last drop out of you and you want one more.
Oh, so Glenfield were paying us.
Yeah. You've got to pay him half your wage. That's how much they don't want you. I'll be honest, I didn't probably know how broken down you were when we signed you. So,
don't think I did either.
Yeah, and it was awkward because, more than probably we let on as well, like, I remember first few sessions and we thought, well, yeah, he's got to get fit, he's got to get going. But again, I could see it in the way you moved. From the Stephen I knew, you didn't move freely, you know, and I could kind of see that. And I thought, he's so linear the way he has to move now. And I was sort of like, okay, we can still use this. And then I think we started off with 2 up front, and then we went to 1 up front in a couple of games. And, you know, for all his faults, Mark Evans was, at that stage, lethal in front of goal. Like,
two goals a game.
Hat-trick a game kind of thing. And it was. And it was. And I think, funnily enough, I called you because I said to Manny, look, I'll front this one. And I remember calling you one time, and it was so awkward. And you were, rightly so, because you were at the stage where your pride, and I think your mind still wanted to finish on a high, but obviously, and I've been there, you don't want to quite admit, I think I'm breaking down here. I think I remember one conversation and you going, well, look, I mean, I don't agree with you, but, you know, I appreciate you calling me. You know, I rang you the day before or something. I think you were in Auckland. And then, funnily enough, we brought you back into the team for the Springs game. And that was when you were through on goal and you got shot by a sniper in the crowd.
Hamstring gone.
And we thought you were done anyway. So yeah. And it was like, it basically like carried off the field. And I kind of thought, well, that kind of justifies that, like, you are done here. Like, he's literally ripped his league in half.
It's quite an interesting evolution from the ego standpoint of someone who's, you know, a starting Northern Premier League striker, yeah. like you say, and then you sort of think you've still got it. And then you're getting benched by your best mate and you're like, he's just doing it because he's a mate and he knows that he's just taking the piss a little bit. And you sort of justify why you're getting dropped. And it's not because you actually haven't been playing very well.
The third dynamic is being a friend who's not involved yeah. and who's watching this play out between two friends. And the you can see the awkwardness between the dynamic.
Yeah.
And it's just the way that as a group that we've handled it is just merciless. Banter.
Well, and that's always been our clique of mates way of dealing with anything, because we'll turn it into relentless
Gags.
Banter.
Yeah.
But I think you got, we all, including yourself, thought you were done, and then it was another one of your miraculous and you actually came back and you had a little run where, kind of what we hoped, I think Metro
got
a hat trick and you were scoring, and then, but again, I just remember like,
was the game he scored a winner at home or an equaliser, last minute equaliser at home? Or did you set one up?
A couple of those.
Yeah, there was a few. No, there was. But again, I remember, I think even you got to the point by the end, you sort of with the knees and you were like, I have to pop about 4 Voltaren to train. Yeah. And we were sort of...
So oh, that's right. I remember walking back with you after a session.
Yeah.
And you were just broken.
I can't continue this. It's not healthy.
No.
In 3 years.
And to be fair to you, I think by the last third of the season, you'd probably, coming on for 35, 40 minutes.
Oh, yeah, made my peace with it.
You were okay with it. And that actually worked really well, you know. And I remember, funnily enough, it lives with me to this day, that the promotion game came down to the Manukau game. And I actually remember you...
Could have snuck it out.
But being one of the ones that was actually really desperate to get us over the line. And I remember thinking like, yeah, that was a really good sign of your character, that although you weren't able to do the role you had been doing where you were the main guy, the main threat, the main front man, you still had that drive to compete and win, that coming on for 30 minutes, you were actually the one like kicking a few of them up the arse, like, come on, we can do this. And then unfortunately... We'd made a plan that we were playing Metro in a dead rubber the last game of the season. Stephen was 3 goals off the club record. We'd beaten Metro 11-0, and then Metro defaulted the game.
I remember the Tuesday before that, and you were saying, look, this is your game. You're on penalties, free kicks, whatever you want. It's just about getting you to this record. And they default the only time in Northern League history.
So hey, but you're back.
Cheers, Metro.
You're doing,
I learned to breathe again.
You're doing your breathing, you know, your ice stuff.
Ian McGrath, if you're listening, you know, maybe there's another
life in the old dog yet.
Sorry,
because I know that you get upset about the
dogs,
canine stuff.
Right, let's switch to New Zealand football, Wilky, because there's, again, a bit of a sort of a love-hate relationship. You're good now, but I think that we did a big article about you and Maney, and you sort of made comment on the fact that during your younger years, you were outside of the tent pissing in, and then you came back to New Zealand and you made a decision when you were at Melville that you would rather be on the inside trying to help instead of just firing shots. So you came into the New Zealand football environment and did a bit of work there, and then you sort of bounced back out again. And where's that at now? And how would you describe that process?
Yeah, I was thinking about this. I've naturally always been a little bit anti-establishment. I can trace that, I think, back to my 2 coaching influences, Beefy Botham. obviously, Rog, who was the original, you know, battling with the system and this is it right, calling people out. And John Cartwright, who in England, with the English FA, was exactly the same. I sat at a coaching conference for Premier League Academy managers where John was the keynote speaker, and he opened with the statement, you're all failing at your job. And he was my mentor, you know, so I'd always had that kind of, the system's wrong, we need to rebel, we need to fight the system.
Declan Edge sort of.
A little bit like that, yeah, 100%. So I think that is in my personality. I've learnt again, I'm trying as I get older to be, without compromising or selling my soul or compromising on my beliefs, work with people more, get more people on side, be prepared to go inside the tent, to use your analogy. So where am I at the moment? Look, I'm good with it. A lot of my frustration towards the hierarchy in New Zealand football has just been about wanting the game to do well here and wanting us to be successful, seeing what we could be as a football nation and getting incredibly frustrated that that hasn't happened. I think New Zealand football will be the first to admit the fact they've just had to have a huge external review process would say that like they haven't got things spot on. And I'm not the only one. There's people like me whose whole lives have been built around football in New Zealand, and we want it to be successful. And when it's not, it drives you mad. And when you think the people that have the most influence aren't doing that as well as they could do, you do get angry. And I'm a classic one for that. I'm no different. Look, I'm working for the Wellington Phoenix now. I've gone inside the tent of one of those organisations, so I would say, you know, that's a sign that I am more open to the idea. I'm not just going to be that guy who's slagging everything off, and I don't want to be that guy. I'm got no issues. I like the direction New Zealand football going. I think Danny Hayes is a great appointment. He's probably not a million miles away from me in terms of a very driven, ambitious...
Bald man.
I think that's harsh on Sam.
That's Hazy's question.
But yeah, and he's a Kiwi, and I think he sees the potential, and I like the fact that we've got one of our own to, you know, to take the head role. So I really like that direction. I still think we've got a tremendous amount of work to do in this country at all levels of the game, but I've got no issues with New Zealand football at the moment. And I hope it will continue.
If you're listening, New Zealand football, yeah.
And if the opportunity arose to be involved in some capacity, I had a good chat with Owain Prosser, a friend of the show's, not long ago about being involved in some of the coach development process. And yeah, I'm if people feel I've got some value to add, I'm willing and able to work with them for the good of the game.
Well, I've been in the tent, and I was in the tent with you.
You
in the Solomons, and you were really good. And I think if the opportunity came to get back in the tent, you should get back in the tent.
Yeah, I'd love to. I'd love to. Look, make no bones about this. If someone rang up tomorrow and said,
"Well, it's Christmas tomorrow, so they won't." Yeah, they probably won't.
Well, don't call on Christmas
if they're serious. If you are calling, I will answer on Christmas. There's an age group coaching job. I would take it tomorrow. I'd be incredibly proud, and I'm not perfect, but I feel like I have value to add to the game on the national level, and I would love to be involved.
You get me and Maney back?
Yes.
To help band. Are you just saying that because we're
no,
recording?
I'm not saying it.
Why'd you look away?
Fluffy moment here.
Don't do this.
Maney's a top coach, he is, and when you can sort of get him away from the fishing and the hunting,
rock climbing,
the gardening,
children,
the children, the wife,
yeah,
the busyness in general, yeah. He's a top coach, he is. And and you, when you are around, you do reply to my messages and you answer your phone. I have never met anyone that has as much impact and relationship with players as you do, and you can't put a price on that. So if I was lucky enough to be given the opportunity, I would like nothing more than for you to, and I'm sure we can find a role for Steve.
This is getting tough. I'm not used to this in the chat. Well, let's go a little bit more personal, Wilkie, and I'm not sure how open you'll be to talking about this, but you are getting married in 2 weeks' time,
yep,
which symbolises a big change. You know, you're a family man all of a sudden. You're thinking about, you know, what's best for two instead of one. you know, a lot of your friends have families and kids, and it's something that I know
some don't.
Through discussions, it's something you're thinking about. What's the reality of, you know, you're working at the Phoenix at the moment, you're there, I'm not sure what length your contract is, but Megs has moved to Wellington with you. What is the reality of thinking about having a kid and where the job sort of security is as a coach? Because chances are you'll be moving around for the next gig, and I don't know, is there a stability at the Phoenix? What does that look like?
Yeah, I think there is a stability at the Phoenix. I think the club's probably in the most stable position it's been for a long time with the league restructuring, or the way it, you know, there's more longevity now than ever. But I think, look, coaching will never be particularly long term. I'm thoroughly enjoying my role at the Phoenix, but what I would say is one thing the last 2 or 3 months has probably clarified for me is that I still have a burning desire to be a head coach at senior level. I'm not sure when that will be, and I've got no plans to leave, but at some stage that is on my radar. And that job in particular, you move, you have to be prepared to pack your bags. You're 4 losses out of 5 away from getting binned off, and the higher up you go. So I've always tried to be Megs. Megs is a good girl. She's very understanding.
Friend of the show.
She is a big fan.
She's listened to all bar Roland Jeffrey.
That's no slight on Roland. It's just the festive season.
No, it is
season.
A slight on Roland.
people are busy.
I've got a slight on Roland while we've got it. Because,
go on.
Granted, I haven't professionally worked with Roland, but I've met Roland 3 or 4 times socially, I would say. I'm a good friend of Adam Crump, who's a very good friend of Roland's. And every time I've met Roland, he's introduced himself to me like it's the first time we've met. Even to the point where the 5th time we'd crossed paths at D Singh's birthday, I said, "How you doing, Roland?" And he went, "Hi, I'm Roland."
Yeah.
And I thought, well, the fact that I've said Roland means we must know each other.
Some people just not very memorable, I think.
Yeah, exactly. So while you lot are all gushing about it, I thought he was an absolute arsehole.
Yeah. Oh, that's good to know.
I'm only joking, Roland. Please remember me next time we see each other. Yeah, it does change things. I battle with this quite constantly. For many a year, the thought of me getting married was so far from a reality. It was never something I had to contemplate. I think you would have got incredibly long odds on me finding a woman that was willing to spend the rest of her life with me. I'm very grateful that I have found said woman. But I think, look, I've been quite open and honest with Megs from day one that life with me will never be straightforward in any capacity. She's very supportive. Kids is a very scary thought, I won't lie. I should probably say kid. Well, I hope I do. But you can choose how many you have these days, can't you?
Yeah, I think so.
I'm sure that's the thing. So, yeah, look, if and when that comes into play, that will be a factor. I don't think marriage initially will change things too much. I've been living with Megs for the last 2 years, so I'm not going to start skipping trains on a Thursday to go on date night or anything lame like that. So
sorry, Michael, we didn't mean to out.
Yeah, sorry, Manny, sorry. Like that. But yeah, it's definitely something you have to factor in. You know, look, when I was working in England, I always had the capacity to just literally pack my bag and head off for the next job or move. Now I've at least got to give Megs a text before we leave and move cities. So it has changed things massively. And I'm sure it will change more.
Let's jump back to your playing days. You played with a young Chris Wood.
Yeah.
And people that know, but people that maybe don't know, Wilkinson family had a big hand in Woodsy going to the UK.
Yeah.
Even at that young age, did you think he would become the player that he is today?
No, I didn't see the speed of his rise. I played with him when I think he was 15, playing in the Northern Premier League for Wanderers. We didn't have a great team that season, and he scored about 12, 13, 14 goals without playing necessarily every week. So that caught mine and everyone's eye straight away, the fact. And he was a big boy, but he wasn't doing it on size, if that makes sense. He was just a really good finisher. He had that instinct and knack to read and assess play. Dad obviously picked up on it. Now, Dad had worked with him that season. Dad, like me, probably never claims the development of players, but through Dad's contacts at West Bromwich Albion, he got Woodsy a trial. Woodsy did very well, so, I mean, look, it's all on the player. But as it happened, Dad, at the time Woodsy went to take up his apprenticeship, Dad also moved back to England and ended up accepting a role at West Brom as the under-18 coach with Michael Appleton. So, timing-wise, worked with Woodsy for his first season as a scholar, which was, I think Woodsy's the first to say, was great, having a familiar face and having someone who's in your corner a little bit more than normal. But in terms of, he was before the end of his first year as a scholar, so literally 10 months from playing in the Northern League for Hamilton Wanderers, he made his debut against Portsmouth, which is freakish. You know, it's a frightening rise, and I don't think anyone could predict that kind of, it's a bit like Sarpreet now. So I knew he'd be a top player. I knew he had a knack that goal scoring's always going to take you places in the game. Did I see him rising that rapidly? No. But having got into the system over there, the fact he's doing so well doesn't surprise me at all. I think he's the type of player, whatever level he played at, he would score goals, and he's always done that.
I remember watching him at St. Paul's, and I was down there to watch Woodsy because there were big raps on him.
To learn off him.
To learn off him, yeah. And he scored a hat-trick without really impacting the game. It was like, if you didn't see his goals, you'd be like, well, what was it all about? Yeah. But he scored a hat-trick, and he ripped shit and bust and headed a ball through a brick wall in a melee, and just, right place, right time.
I think he's probably got the perfect fit. He was probably never a player that had to be involved in loads of the build-up and had to be on the ball all the time. He was a goal scorer, and he's probably got the perfect fit now in terms of the way Burnley play. They're not a team that is overly patient playing out from the back. They're not a team that sets out to dominate the ball. They are a team that, again, do it fantastically well, but attack quite quickly, are quite happy having spells without the ball, and are very good on set pieces. And I think he's just that's the perfect environment for him. And it doesn't surprise me now he's there, that he's in a club with the right fit, that he's I think I saw the other day in 2019 the calendar year he's outscored some ridiculous players like Rashford and people like that. And that doesn't surprise me.
You've coached some players at Birmingham City as well at a young age that are now coming through to the first team. Some of the names that people might look out for?
Yeah, there's one boy stood out from my time in England, a boy called Jude Bellingham. So I worked with Jude right the way through, but Jude was a bit of a special case because he was such a frightening talent. We, as a smaller club, used to, in the holidays, he'd come in and we'd basically babysit him and look after him and spend a lot more time. So he was a great kid, but as much as it is impossible to say this kid's a sure thing, he was the closest at 12 or 13 you could get to a sure bet. He was athletic. He was, skill level was off the charts. He was a really bright kid. Like, even at 13, like, you coach him, you had to be on your game because he'd be questioning things, not in a disrespectful way, but and he was a lovely kid. He had great parents, very humble, very down to earth. And he's now at 16. He's just got the Sky Bet Championship Player of the Month. He's playing every week as a 16-year-old. He was a striker who played a bit as a number 10. He's been playing as a holding midfielder. He could literally play anywhere. He had every club in England, City, Chelsea, offering everything from a house for his parents to a job for his dad. And they said, no, look, if he's happy at Birmingham, he'll stay here. And he's already incredibly well-known. He was the best player I saw in England. We played everyone. We played the big boys, the Arsenals, the Chelseas. He was a frightening talent. And touch wood, if he doesn't suffer any bad injuries, I think he'll go on to be one of the best players in England, if not the world. He's a frightening talent, and if he carries on in the same trajectory, he'll be a frightening talent. I was very lucky to work with him and a number of others. There's three or four in the Birmingham match day squad at the moment that I work with. I don't claim any of their fame. They were good players, and I was just very lucky to work with them. I had a really good relationship with some of them, and it's really nice being in New Zealand now to watch games and see lads that I had at under 14. Likewise with West Brom, the first group I ever worked with at under 14. It was a freakish group, and there's five or six of those playing for West Brom. Kyle Edwards, Jonathan Lico, Sam Field, playing at other clubs in the Championship that have all kicked on and done really well. So, yeah, I see working with those players more that I was lucky to work with them, and that it's great for me as a coach to have seen where they were at 14, 15, 16, where they got to now, and apply some of that to kids that I work with now. So
speaking of kids that you work with now, who New Zealand-wise do you think has the potential to go places?
Was he going to say it? Balls on the line.
I haven't worked across the board. I've worked with the lads, Hamilton based players. I've worked with some boys at the Phoenix. I don't work with Libby Kikache. He occasionally drops into the team. I took him in a pre-season game, but I've seen him at close quarters, and I think you talk about having the profile and the tools to go and play what I call as an elite level, is your top leagues in Europe, your Champions League. I think he ticks all those boxes. I think he could more than comfortably, given the opportunity, go and play in a Serie A or a Premier League.
The Herald, I think last week, named him as the number one teenage...
Really?
Male teenage talent.
Huge reps.
Was it male or was it... Because there was a bit of flack about that, wasn't there?
There were two lists.
Ah.
Yeah.
Planned.
He was on the male list.
He was on the male list.
Yeah. On top of that, look,
that's premium content, by the way, so you have to
subscribe
to get
I
that.
Just get Gavin Douglas to send me screenshots. On top of that, Sam Sutton, I think, is a super talent.
Also on the list. Number nine, I think
Sam's work ethic and drive to be a player, from the limited time I've spent with him, will give him a really good chance of kicking on. Below that, there's some... I probably shouldn't name some of the younger boys in the academy.
We don't need to go into that.
Yeah.
I mean, just read the article.
Read the article. $2.50.
How's our list looking, Shay?
Yeah, I mean, you talk nostalgically about watching Rog, Waikato United times. I mean, I wasn't around for that sort of stuff, so I don't really know how much of an impact that had, but it sounds like it kind of did for both of you, familiar with Muir Park and bits and pieces.
Yeah, massive. That was my childhood. And probably shaped a lot of what I do now. Waikato United, training four nights a week, training at Porritt. I used to be there every training. I'd tag along with Dad and kick a ball around the side of the pitch, fetch the balls. Sundays would be reps in the morning, rep football for us, and then I'd be at Muir Park with Donald and Stephen and Michael Smith behind the goal, harassing the opposition goalkeeper. And it was... I look back on that really fond memories, and a really good team, a good era for Waikato football. Declan, Brian Hayes, Darren Fellows, Darren Melville, like really strong characters. We had a Waikato team that, I wouldn't say punched above its weight, but were top two or three in the National League every year, won the Chatham Cup, and were, 92 were a kick away from winning the National League and the Cup double. So to not only be on the inside track of your dad being the coach, but to be a mad football fan and have a really vibrant region, that was one of the huge draws of coming back to Melville, is trying to get that feel back into the region, and it still is. You know, I'd love nothing more than at the right time and the right environment to come back and get hold of a club here and galvanise the region, because I look back so fondly on those times. 95 semi-final at North Shore, Paul Caton equalises in the 93rd minute, we young fans face paint storm the pitch, went on penalties. Like, I look back at those moments and I can remember them like they were yesterday. So massive influence on me. I would probably say spending most of my childhood around a football team with a lot of English characters shaped my humour and my sometimes
accent.
Well, I'm not mainly with that, but about barbed humour, you know, that all came from listening to jokes that I shouldn't have been listening to, and lads hammer each other around the changing room when I was 9 or 10, and yeah, great times.
And a couple of guests before have shared some Rog stories.
Mm.
You've been front and centre for a lot of those Rog stories. Are there any ones that spring to mind that haven't been told that are maybe worth telling? I mean, I think you didn't feed us the best Buncey story.
Yeah. Well, it's hard. Rog, there are so many with Rog. Explosions, fights. But the Buncey story I said should have been told was, I think the Buncey alluded to, Rog had left Waikato United and then came back in Edge's second season. Again, doomed from the start as a partnership, but Rog, when it wasn't working and they'd had a fight at training, Rog stepped down, said, look, Eddie was here first, he carries on. Results hadn't gone their way. And you got to remember as well, this was when Waikato United, the National League, was quite a big deal. Front and centre of the back page of the Waikato Times every week. There was interest in football back then. So leading up to a home game and results weren't going well, story breaks in the Times that someone's broken into Muir Park and spray painted "Bring back Rog" in huge writing across the pitch. It's in the paper, you know, not great for Eddie and a bit disrespectful, so not by any way something I would condone. But it was Shea Bunce, Gavin Pooley, and I believe Scott Granville, friend of the show, had broken in and done it. And as the story goes, had only brought one spray can, and it had started to run out by the end, so it starts in big bold, "Bring back," but the "jur" at the end starts tailing off into like single file. And that was Buncey, who was playing for Waikato at the time. So
good,
cats out the bag, Buncey there. But yeah,
Buncey,
yeah,
former friend of the show.
Yeah.
Expect a legal letter.
And just I'll add to that while we're on the Buncey. So again, talking about my childhood, one of Roger's many failed entrepreneurial ventures was opening a soccer shop in Collingwood Court.
I remember that shop.
Pre-Shane Comber.
Long time before that. Pre-Rebel Sport, pre-everything.
Yeah.
So always looking to save a buck. Cheap bit of cash labour was a young centre-half by the name of Shea Bunce, who would basically sit in an empty shop all day, not to deal with the customers. And the classic Buncey story was that he would always bike in and then forget that he biked in, start walking home, and then turn back up at the shop an hour later and go, "Biked in today, didn't I?" Forget the bike. So there you go. Another huge influence on my childhood, unfortunately, Shea Bunce.
Yeah, well, that is, I think that might be a wrap. That's been a great hour, 46 minutes. Mm. I think we've covered it all.
Is that the record?
I think we might have just surpassed Embers, who did an hour 40. So for those of you who are still with us, I hope you've enjoyed it, because we bloody have.